Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have the roll call, please.
Commissioner Sonio?
Present.
Commissioner Forbes?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Present.
Commissioner Purvis?
Here.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Here.
Commissioner White?
Here.
Chairperson McGregor?
Here.
Does anybody want anything pulled from the consent agenda for individual consideration?
I do.
What would you like pulled?
Operations report.
Okay.
And only because I have a question.
Only because you have a question, okay. All right, then we'll take them individually. The minutes for the May 24th meeting, has everybody had a chance to look those over? And if so, we'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
And moved and seconded to approve. Any further discussion? Not, roll call please, Chris.
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Forbes?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approved.
Commissioner White?
Approved.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
The operations and fuel flowage reports, and Commissioner Sonio.
You don't have the numbers for June or July, Chris?
When I don't get the numbers until after the end of the month, and I had already posted this agenda before I got numbers for July, because I have to post the week before.
What about June?
June's on there.
June's on there.
No, I don't have a June, and I on either copy.
Oh.
I see.
For operations?
Under operations.
Oh, operations.
Yeah.
I was
looking at the fuel
book. Yeah, I've got June.
June on mine.
6,255.
Oh, under operations?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because there was the one I printed, the one that's on the table here, and the one I picked up in the back.
Huh.
Or the front of the building, as the case may be.
Okay, it was...
So June is what?
6,255.
6,255, okay.
So what do you have for your total?
4,630. Oh, wait, no, 10-year monthly, what, total where?
Annual?
Oh, 24,596.
Okay, that should be 30,852.
30,000
what?
852.
I have a question.
Mine are also that way.
Huh. Commissioner Purvis?
Yeah, Chris, we used to have a running total column in there. Not really a running total, but a subtotal through the month. Didn't we have a subtotal?
No, we have that. The annual total at the.
Yeah, but the annual total.
That's to that date through.
Oh,
June.
It is.
Yeah.
Year to date.
Couldn't be anything else because that's 2018.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Never mind.
Yeah, bring.
I'm total. Good.
Okay. Cool. All right. Any other questions on the operations or the fuel reports? Not. I'll entertain a motion.
Move to accept.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the fuel flowage and the operations. All in favor? I'm sorry, Chris, roll call please.
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Forbes?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approved.
Commissioner White?
Approved.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the election of commission officers. And according to the protocol, the vice chairperson will be elected first. So the nominations are open for the vice chair for the coming year.
And Commissioner, I just wanted to clarify something. As per the bylaws,
Both the chair and vice chair have the opportunity to run for two consecutive year terms. And just for the commission's own knowledge, Chair McGregor has completed his first term, so he's available for a second term. And then Vice Chair Asonio has completed her first term and is available for another term.
Thank you. Commissioner Shoemaker.
I'd like to propose that Commissioner McGregor and Diane Asonio complete a second term.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded that both Commissioner McGregor and Chair and Asonio continue in their spots. Is that acceptable for our...
Let's just do a separate roll call for each one, just because that's how it's written up. Yeah.
Say again. I missed it.
A separate roll call for each one, because that's how it's written up in the bylaws.
Okay.
We'll elect one than the other.
Okay, so let's go for one then the other. So would you like to change...
Okay, I move. I'd like to nominate Diane Asonio for vice chair. I'd like to nominate McGregor for chairman.
Okay, is there a second? And you
want I'll second that again.
Okay, so is there any other? The motions are now closed. I guess it's been seconded. So we will take the roll call vote separately, first on the vice chair and then on the chair, please.
Commissioner Asonio?
Voting for yourself.
It's good. You can always abstain, I guess.
Yeah.
She got one. Yeah.
I said approved. Sorry.
Thank you. Commissioner Fors?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approve.
Commissioner White?
Approve.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
And now the roll call for the chairman, please.
Commissioner Sonio?
Approved.
Commissioner Fors?
Approved.
Commissioner Johnson?
Approved.
Commissioner Purvis?
Approved.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Approve.
Commissioner White?
Approve.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
Okay, now that we've finished that little piece of business and I'm the chairman one more year, we won't have to switch chairs, but I would like to just make one comment about Robert's Rules of Order. There are two responses to motions when they're taking the roll call, and that's aye and nay, or aye and no. Approved really is not a proper term according to Robert's Rules of Order, so I think to keep everything on the up and up, we should kind of follow those rules, since that's what it says in our bylaws.
So do you want to do that over again?
No, it'll be okay. But in the future, let's stick to that if we...
So please.
Aye or no.
Yes.
Aye or no.
Aye or no. Or yes and nay, no, or aye and nay. But if you read them, it says it kind of stipulates aye and no.
So is approved all the way around not approved?
For anything, yeah. Because when you have a motion for approval... You know, you're saying aye or no to that approval. So that's the normal response and the accepted response according to Robert's Rules of Orders for any roll call motion.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Having that little ditty out of the way, let's move on, please, to the California International Air Show.
And good evening, Chair McGregor and Commission. Before I get into my report, I wanted to introduce President of the Air Show, Don Chapin III, and give him a few minutes to provide you an update, and then we can roll into my report.
Thank you.
Good evening, Commission. How are you?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Don Chapin here, President of the Air Show. And I just wanted to come and thank you first and foremost for having me attend and giving me a few moments to kind of talk about the air show. So we're just about 2 months away, just under 2 months, and we're extremely excited. Our headliner this year is United States Air Force Thunderbird. So we had the Thunderbirds a couple of years ago. They've been rolling in every 2 years for our show. And for the last three shows that they've been here, we were selected as the air show site of the year for the Thunderbirds. And they attend how many countless air shows throughout the country, and they select the Salinas Air Show as their favorite show to come to. So every year they fight to come back and be a part of our community. They love what we do, and they love being a part of our show. So thank you to the commission, as well as the city of Salinas and all of our spectators who come out and really kind of help us put on a good show. Because it's not just us and all the hard work, but it's everybody that stands behind our air show in our city. So thank you. We have some really good performers this year. We've got some new faces, and then we've got some familiar faces that we've had before. We have a Jerry Conley who flies a Vampire jet, which is a really cool, it's almost a P-38 with a jet engine on the back. We have Greg Collier, who was here last year, Vicky Benzing. We have a B-17 scheduled to fly in and do some passes with a couple of P-51s, which will be really pretty exciting. Jess Rodriguez, and then, of course, some ground acts, monster trucks are coming in. We're also working on a Pitts and an extra 300 as well coming in. So we're really excited. This is something that's been gaining some good traction, and we're making some good headway. So we're really excited. I kind of open it up to questions if you guys have any.
Questions for the commission? We're not privileged to have Sean on a swan song year.
Unfortunately not. He had signed for Miramar a long time ago, so that's okay. Unfortunate, but we wish him all the best. We're very unfortunate that we don't have him here. But
any questions from the audience, from the public?
Not
okay, no question. Okay, thank you, Mr. Chapin.
Thank you all very much.
Okay.
So the California International Air Show, the item before the commission is recommendation of this year's air show permit to move on to City Council for final approval. Air shows on September 29th and 30th. A lot of the language that you see in the permit is the same from year to year. The permit is successful, so there's no need to reinvent the wheel. Still the same $5 million air meet liability policy that they're going to provide, and a $1 million commercial general liability policy in addition to that. The biggest changes that you'll see this year is, and you recall when we were working on the budget, there was no $20,000 contribution to the air show as a sponsorship. This doesn't mean that in no way are we not supporting the air show. There's plenty of things that we do to help support and make the air show a success from the city standpoint and the staff standpoint. It's just this year when we were constructing the budget and we have several projects that we're working through, such as the core area development and hangar development on the south side of the airport, in addition to having to have almost $100,000 in matching grants. Our total potential of $100,000 matching grant for our federal projects. It's just that I went to the air show and expressed to them that the enterprise fund was stretched thin. And in any other way possible, we're going to try and support them. And then when we go back to next year and start budgeting, as we start chipping those projects off, we can get back to our normal sponsorship of the air show. In consideration for not being able to provide the sponsorship, to help ease the burden of the cost of the air show, we're waiving the permit fee for the air show. And as part of, because of the contributions that we provide to the air show, they've agreed to continue on with most of the sponsorship provisions that we would normally see, such as using the airport logo in promotional material and any other materials that they develop for the air show, ads, campaigns, etc. They're honoring the long-time provision to provide fundraising opportunities for the air show. They're providing tickets that SOPA then sells in consideration for their efforts towards the air show. The one difference, because we are not contributing to the air show, is that we do not have that pass-through provision in there for the EAA. as a charitable organization. I believe that amounts up to about $750. That is the report. Open for any comments, questions.
Questions from the commissioners? Commissioner Shoemaker?
Yeah, you said it was the same $5 million air meat liability insurance, and my copy says $10 million, and it says $2 million for general liability.
I probably need to correct that because I'm not sure. It'll be corrected because it's the same as years past. I don't know why that's in
there. Because I thought a $10 million all of a sudden sounded
No. That's a typographical error. So in your recommendation, just make sure that you capture with... as amended, we will move that back to the normal amount. I'm not sure how that got in there.
So. Okay. Any other questions, comments from commissioners? If not, any questions or comments from the public? Mr. Teeters.
Good day, commissioners. I appreciate, first of all, I want to thank you all for putting the hours in that you do.
Excuse me, sir. Could you bring the microphone down a little bit more, please?
How's that? That better?
Thank you.
Okay. I want to thank you all for the time you put in and the efforts that you put in to try to keep the airport heading in a good direction. Though the airport tenants mostly don't show up here, we all appreciate it. I'm here this night, haven't been here for a long time, fought several battles many, many years ago trying to build a building, which I never got built. And Gary Peterson came in and he pretty much fixed most of the problems and I just kind of didn't need to come down anymore. And I thought he did a very good job and all of you have done a very good job over the years. We've got a couple small issues coming up. Lori said that none of the tenants show up, so I thought I'd come in tonight. And in regards to the air show, I know there's nothing that's gonna come out of me what I'm gonna say, but I need to say it so that everybody knows, you know, what actually goes on. My wife's gonna divorce me this year probably if I do anything for the air show. She told me last year not to do it because I was gonna get nothing but beat up and I said, no, they're a good deal and I'm gonna help them out. And guess what, I got beat up again. So I have a real problem with the structure of the way the air show is set up. There is tremendous corruption in the security, heads of security, in that if anybody on the airport has a problem and tries to call the police, because of the heads of the security are always either police officers or ex-police officers, no individual is allowed to file a police report on anything that air show people do. You cannot file a report. I've been assaulted. I tried filing a report. I had stuff stolen off my property. I could not file a police report. I was assaulted last year by a guard from, or I think he's a parole officer or something from the prison down there. Wanted to file a police report. I was told by Don Klein, who is an ex-officer, no, you can't do that. I'm not gonna allow it. And I tried to talk to a police officer and he got in between me and the other guy and it never happened. And I brought the issue up with the previous president, and he promised me that he did look into it and came back to me and said that my allegations were warranted and that person would be removed and never allowed to work on the air show committee again as a volunteer. I just asked Mr. Chapin tonight if they were gonna uphold to that, and he told me no, they were gonna move him around to a different spot, okay? There's no room on that airport for people that assault people. There's no room on that airport for people that steal things. And when you have an agency like the Salinas International, California International Air Show, that is supposed to be for charity, and they haven't donated anything for charity for years, and we all keep helping them, at some point they gotta be accountable for what they do. And unfortunately this year, I won't do anything for the air show, but I do not wanna be beat up by the air show. The air show asked me last year if I would be involved in supporting the P-51 Mustangs. And I thought it'd be a great deal. I said, you know what, I will. And so Don Klein and I agreed that we'd have a dinner. They offered to pay for part of it. I said, no. I said, I don't want to do that because if I expect something out of you and you don't come through with it, I apologize. I've got a migraine headache here. You know, I don't want to be disappointed, so just let me pay for it and I'll take care of it. My wife worked very hard. We spent about $12,000 on a dinner. For 30 air show people, of about 20 of them didn't even show up. And for the rest of the people with the P-51s and so forth. During the start of this, the fire department came onto the property, was very abusive to my employees, and told us we had to shut the party down and we had to move the airplanes off the property. And because we didn't do anything wrong, as usual, I can be kind of hard, I stood my ground and told the guy to get off the property. The air show people never came over. Don Klein was there. He didn't do anything to try to help me out with the fire department. The police came. They pretty much, I think, told the fire department to hit the road. It was a very abusive deal, and I'm tired of that. I pay rent out there. I run a legitimate business. There's not a one of you, if you came into my facility and told me you needed some help on your airplane or needed something, that I wouldn't help you or donate to you in some way or shape or form. I'm going to ask you to put a stipulation on this permit, and that is that you put on there that nobody related to the police force can be on the security team as far as the lead man. And that is because there is collusion in the Salinas or California International Air Show and the police department. And I don't think it's the police department's fault. I think it's the individuals who are involved with the air show that are abusing their power. And so I would appreciate it if you could do anything about that. Thank you very much.
Dave, are you open for questions?
Yes.
Yes, does any of the commissioners have any questions for Mr. Dieters?
Yeah, Dave, is run it by me what you want. Again, the don't want a police officer to be head of security?
Well, they have a head of security they've had in the past. It's always been police officers or somebody who's retired from the police force. And you get a real collusion there because if somebody's doing something wrong, the guy that's been in charge every time has covered up for the air show so that you cannot file a police report. I have been robbed, stolen from my business, physically assaulted every time. Tried now, this is over since the air show started. It's not something that just happened. It's been going on for years. And when you cannot file a police report for somebody who has done something criminal, there is something wrong. And that is a really bad way to be running something on the airport. And so I'm just asking, because they will not control it. It's not that they can't, they can. They will not control it. So I'm asking you to put a stipulation in there that they have to have a third party other than a police official or somebody that's involved in law enforcement that heads up their security for this year. And I would appreciate anything you could do for me.
Commissioner Sonio.
Dave, is it specifically somebody from Salinas PD, or is it the local sheriff or the highway patrol?
I don't remember what the black guy's name was, but he was horrible about it. Don Klein did it last year, okay. What was the gentleman's name that ran it for? Brandon Hill. He was horrible. I mean, just absolutely horrible.
And is he current or retired?
They broke into my facility. The Salinas Air Show did. Took my $23,000 tug. I went and got my tug back, okay? I didn't touch anybody. I got assaulted as I was driving off. The guy put his arms around my neck from behind me, bent me over the back of my tug. There were people there that saw it, confirmed witnesses, and I could not file an assault charge. That's wrong. Okay, my hangar got broke into. I could not file a charge. Last year, I was trying to get tables for the party through, and this gentleman, I got a picture of him, and I promise I'll put it on Facebook if I see that guy out there this year. He was just so nasty and mean. He literally, I backed up from him and said, I don't want to have an argument with you. He came up and kicked my toes, and he says, you're too close to me, move away. And all I was trying to do was put on a party for the air show. That was it. So I ended up paying two guys to hand carry tables from over where TMP is all the way over to my facility because they wouldn't let the truck through. That's wrong. That's not a group of people who are trying to do good for the community, okay? We don't have room for that at the airport. Now, like I said, I don't expect a whole lot to be done. I just want it to be known. This has been going on for years, okay? I've been in my facility and assaulted. And everybody's well aware of it. There's nobody on that airport that will let the Salinas or California International Air Show use their property anymore for the same reasons. Nobody spoke up because nobody wants to hurt them because they're supposed to be a good organization. Fact is, they're pretty much run into ground. They haven't given any charity for years. In fact, when they were given charity, I was donating to the Young Eagles. Sitting at Christmas one year with Lori, and she was talking about the money for the Young Eagles, and I said, hey, I've been donating, you should have some money. They never got their donation. I went over to Sherry, and I had to threaten her and the air show that I was gonna call the IRS before they gave the money to the Young Eagles. That's not a good business practice.
Okay. Are there any other questions or comments from the commissioners? I just have one question, Dave. Have you made this request to anybody else but the airport commission?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know who to make it to other than you guys, to be honest with you. Okay, because no matter who I talk to, they just keep sweeping this stuff up under the table, and it's not good.
Hey, any questions from the audience? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Godin, any comments?
I don't want to speak on behalf of the air show, but I know that they've had a change in leadership this last year, where they've brought in some more of their historical figures that are more familiar with running more modern air shows and understand the customer service side of it. We do recognize that there's been issues, and it's every year something gets presented to us. We try working with the air show organization. What we have to remember is, I'm not trying to justify anything that's happening, is that it's a volunteer organization. And so sometimes there are some bad weeds that fall in. I know the longtime security director was replaced last year, and we were hopeful to have a good working relationship. It was a first year that I, of my understanding, having a new security director in there, and there were some issues. And every year after the air show happens, we have a debrief and we try to work through those issues. And I think one of the primary issues that I've stressed over my 5 years is the working relationship that we have with Dave Teeters and his organization. We really try to improve those relationships. I've worked with the past president of the air show, the executive director, and some years I think it's good, and some years there are some issues because of volunteers. So, is there anything? Yeah, if there's anything you'd like to say.
Mr. Chapin.
Yes. We love to be a good tenant to the airport and to all the other tenants in town. And unfortunately, as Brett mentioned, there are a few bad weeds in volunteers. We have roughly about 1,000 volunteers that show up over the weekend. So we try and do our best to give them good direction and ask that they, in turn, give us their best. Sometimes that does not work. Again, I'm not sure when the theft happened with the tug or that assault, the previous assault. I'm not sure when that was. It definitely was not last year, correct? That was years past. But I know there was the incident he was mentioning with the individual from security. I am looking into that, and I'm working with Mr. Teeters. I did talk to him earlier about not having that volunteer back, because I understand that, you know, security is a big part of our show. Having a secure grounds and making sure that not only tenants but our spectators feel comfortable and they feel safe, and knowing that somebody can make a report against us or against our volunteers. I've had no direction to anybody that they are allowed to stop some sort of police investigation or making making a report, filing a report, any such as that. That was has nothing from the air show, no air show direction. So I will be talking to our security director, making sure that that message is very clear and very understood. And we want to make sure that everybody is feeling safe and there's no issues. We do try and strive to make it the best possible, and we do the best we can. We do have some new folks involved. We have a new interim executive director, Mr. Harry Wardwell. And we also have some past presidents and our directors emeritus, the Gaddises, my father. We had Sherry Isaac before she passed. And some other key influencers in our town who have stepped up and have come back into the fold and have really kind of helped push this air show to what it is coming to this year. So,
Commissioner Sonia.
Don, who is the air show the security director this year?
Don Klein.
So you're still...
His first year. Last year was his first year, and with most directors, there's always some growing issues. There's some growing pains.
Well, but the issue seems to be that the fact that it's either current or former Salinas PD, specifically,
and that,
I don't know.
In most organizations for nonprofits that need volunteers, especially for security, they typically fall with past officers because they have the history in security. And understanding how law enforcement and security.
But we're all aware of the thin blue line.
Oh, absolutely. Understood that.
So maybe that is something that needs, probably too late for this year, but that needs to be taken and care of. And then something else that Dave mentioned regarding donations, that maybe by October or November, we should have an accounting of your
Absolutely.
Donations.
And we can give you an account of last year's donations. We donate every year to I think roughly at least 20 organizations that come out and volunteer. Some payments have been delayed. I won't lie about that, but they've all been paid.
Okay. I would like to see that.
Yeah, we can do that.
Commissioner Johnson.
One of the things that I mentioned a while ago was the thousand volunteers that come on site at the airfield, and there are rules and special etiquette, just like you would a church, but it's an airfield. Mm-hmm. And my complaint at that time was these people don't understand the airfield, which would also entail Mr. Teeter's business and the other businesses on the airfield. What have you done for that training for all of these 1,000 people that come on board onto the site?
Absolutely. I can't agree with you more. I think it is one of our hardest challenges to get volunteers trained and understand that this is an airport. This isn't just your backyard neighborhood to come in and just go play around. This is still an active airport. And so understanding the rules and requirements that we have to follow when we're on an airport, and that there's still planes taxiing in and out of this place. And we need to make sure that businesses are still operating and everything is being accounted for. So last year was the first year we implemented it. We had a volunteer coordinator, and every volunteer, we tried to get every volunteer, I'm sure there's a few that sneak through the cracks. We each gave them a full 11 by 8.5 about all the rules, airport rules, air show rules, how to conduct themselves, how to operate as a volunteer for the air show. We did have some success. I think there was a lot of folks that had an eye-opening experience about what was on that list and how to act. But then, there's still some bad apples that don't really care what rules are out there. They might say, yes, I'm going to listen, and go off and do their own thing. So we do try and keep an eye out for those apples that are not in favor of our rules and ask them not to come back. But we do try and do the best job we possibly can. So we're continuing with that tradition now of introducing those rules to each one of our volunteers and asking them to adhere to them and follow our safety guidelines as well.
Is there some sort of meeting that all the volunteers come and...
Unfortunately, no, because there's a lot of volunteers that are from high schools, and unfortunately, they're typically out of high school or out of school during the summer months. We do actually meet with the leaders of those groups and give them direction. Those were a lot of our volunteers are actually high school students and ROTC, and for the majority, they're really good. Every single one of them are absolutely phenomenal. They work really hard. They do a good job. It's always, unfortunately, those weeds that stick up that make your lawn so ugly. Most of your lawn is beautiful, and there's always that one weed that makes everything look bad. Right? So we're trying to capture those weeds and pick them out and get new grass to grow in the good place.
I'll get to the public just as soon as the commissioners are done asking questions.
Sorry. Is there any way to get a list of those rules or whatever you give
Absolutely.
Them? I would appreciate that.
Okay. Commissioner Forrest, do you have a question?
I have a concern about the security and the gentleman that's not be able to file a report. Is he saying, or are you saying, that if a crime is committed during the air show by two civilian people, that the police department cannot come in and file a report and or arrest whoever needs to be arrested?
We have no rules above the law enforcement. The law enforcement has they have the highest power out there. So if they would like to file a report, it is completely onto them. We've given no direction to anybody to stop that process.
Okay. Well, why this gentleman cannot file a report?
I do not know whether there was some communication between our security director and the police officer. Ultimately, the responsibility falls on the officer.
I would request that you look into that.
Absolutely.
Find out, why he can't file. If an assault has been committed, he has every right.
Absolutely.
Every right. To file a report.
I completely agree.
Thank you.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
I have one question and one comment. Don, did you say that you did your pass-throughs this year? You're able to do...
So our donations every year go to the groups that come out and volunteer for us. Charity donations in that regard. So parking, concessionaires, all those are volunteer groups, ROTC, parking, trash. Everybody that comes in as a volunteer in those capacities, we've negotiated stipends for them. That's our donation for the year. There is a pass-through that we try and do through our President's Club as soon as the financial obligations are met through the air show. And if they're not, unfortunately, a pass-through does not go through. It still goes to our charity. We are a 501c3. So there is still that charity donation. However, it is not being passed through. It's a financial obligation of the air show have not been met.
So that answer is no.
So the pass-through from the President's Club has not gone through. However, there is still our donations to the community.
No, I'm asking about the pass-throughs.
Yes, the pass-through has not gone through. Is 15 and 16 did not go through.
15 and 16?
2015
17
and
they did, 18 they didn't.
I'm sorry, I'm 1 year off. 17 and 16 did not go through.
Okay, because I thought I heard you say earlier that all of your donations had been
our
done,
donations
and,
to the
but
groups.
Now you're saying,
I'm sorry.
No, the pass-throughs did not.
I might have misspoken.
Okay,
it's to the groups that are out volunteering with man hours and have volunteered their time.
Okay.
Those groups have all been paid.
Okay. Comment is, I don't know how we can put into the permit anything that would constrain or restrict or top or limit your volunteers or your operation. So I don't know that we're the right that we're the right place to control that. I think that now you know what the situation is, you're better able to address this than we could in a permit process.
Okay. Commissioner Sonio.
Well, and the concern now that these issues have been brought to our attention, and if something should get really out of hand, more so than what it has been in the past, we have just, we're knowledgeable, could be liable, and personally, I don't want to get sued. And I'm pretty sure, you know, and neither do you, so, or the air show. So I think something, this needs to be seriously looked at.
But I'm not so sure that should be part of the permitting process. I'm kind of with Commissioner Shoemaker on that end of things. I don't know that you can put something in there that you can say you can't have a certain group work in a certain area.
It's something to discuss with Chris Callahan, the city attorney.
Anyway, Commissioner Forrest.
Yeah, I'd just like to request that, you know, the things that I'd asked you to look into, I'd like you to come back at our next meeting and give us, you know, some information on that. So if we do make any kind of decisions here, that will help us make that decision.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Teeters.
First of all, I want to make clear, because I think maybe things got off the side just a little bit. This isn't the volunteers that are the general volunteers, okay? I'm very tolerant of that. You know, they come out, they don't even know what an airport is, a lot of them. I'm very tolerant of that. That's not what this is. This is the people that are high up in the air show people, the people that go to the meetings, the people that know they're not supposed to be doing it. Don's been made aware of this. The air show people have been made aware of this. This isn't new to Don. So to, you know, I respect you very much because you're just hearing this, but to think that he's just heard it and now he can address it, I think is a little bit short in the fact that it's been there. I was threatened and told that if I didn't drop the charges when my stuff got stolen and I got assaulted, that if I didn't back off, that they, air show, would have me arrested and would throw me in jail and I would be the criminal. And I was told that. That's how serious this is. Okay, I'm done. I got it again last year. And I understand you can't put much in the deal, but what you can put in there is that they come back to you with a policy for discipline for their own people, because the reason why the policy's there is because there's no discipline. I'd like to ask Mr. Chapin, what did he do to discipline the individuals last year that did that? Nothing. They're letting them come back this year, okay? It's a good old boy group, you know? They're a nonprofit charity. They're having a good time. They're not donating much to the community anymore, but they protect their own, and it is with inside. And this isn't something that's new. And I did get told by the gentleman, not Don Klein, but the other gentleman, that they would have me arrested if I pursued it.
Okay, thank you,
okay,
Dave.
Let's
not get into character deal. Lori?
On behalf of the Airport Business Association, I can attest, some years we have pre-air show meetings with the air show board members, some years we don't. Last year we did, and it was a prearranged stipulation that Dave would have access to the gate by his business to let the vendors in to set up for the party. And the day of the event, they said, no, you can't. And it throws all an organization into disarray. Then he's out trying to find his vendors who are routed around the airport. His vendors can't make their other commitments because they're stuck in traffic, and that's how it happened. That is typical of the airshow board, and that is why Cal Pacific Air Motive has just backed away and said, you can't park on our ramp anymore. We just don't want to be part of the drama. And so it is not so much the volunteers, it is higher up. And I think, you know, they have good intentions, but the day of the event, things always change. And we're told things will go a certain way, and they understand what's going on. And I think that there are people that are trying to improve that. But last year, there was no reason for that situation with Dave's vendors to even happen. The airport manager was there, the air show board was there, the airport businesses were there, and he was very explicit to keep the traffic out of the air show's way. If we could just come through the gate by my business, it'll eliminate the issue. And at the last minute, somebody with the air show says, no, you can't open the gate. And it's typical.
Okay. I ran a business out at the airport for 11 years during air show years and was the chief pilot for Tanimer and Attle for another 11, so worked with the air show quite closely. And I will have to say that there was always a little bit of a we own the airport this weekend attitude. And I think it was always there and always has been. And of course, I have not been out there for the last, 12 years now, so I can't tell you what's going on then. But I know in those past years, there has been that kind of an attitude. And it's always something we've battled, you know, through all the airport managers, Jim Chappell, Gary Peterson, and now Brett, and I can't remember his name now. Mark Batista in there too, but we work through with all of those. And I think it is a general problem that's, and again, I was on the board of the air show for a few years too, and I remember being in there and trying to defend our position on things like that. So Don, I think it is a little bit of a problem in there and something that needs to be addressed, and you have to recognize that the businesses still operate on that airport and the air show doesn't own it. And with that, I will cease my comments. We do have a permit resolution in front of us, and unless there are other issues to come up on that, again, I don't think that we're in a position to say that, tell the air show who they can have as volunteers and who they can't. But we are in a position to deny a permit, I guess, if that's what it came down to. And I don't think we're at that point, but are there any other comments or questions from the commission? Commissioner Sonio?
I just noticed our next meeting is on August 23rd, which is 3 weeks from today, thereabouts, and it's still about a month before the air show. Don, can you come back with some policies that will be in place for the air show? And I think we should table this permit until the next meeting.
I don't think we're in a position to be able to table the permit just with the city council and everything else, so I don't think that's an option.
Why not?
I have a comment. Time is such that in order for them to receive their special event permit, that they have to have this agreement in place in order for them to receive the city special event permit. So timing is such that we can't delay it until August 23rd. Just a few comments, just from some of the things I've heard. I think each year, because it is a volunteer organization, and I understand that there's some issues in the higher ups, we work through those issues. And last year was the first year that we had really good momentum moving into the air show, and we anticipate having that again by having another tenant meeting. I would say when we finished up the tenant meeting with the president of the air show and the businesses, I think that most people felt pretty good about the direction from a safety standpoint, personnel standpoint. And during the day of the air show, there's always issues. There's a lot of things that happen behind the scene. But from a standpoint, is the air show any less safe? Or an issue that would prevent this from happening? No. The air show is well suited to move forward with hosting this event this year. And I think that these are issues that we should be able to work through as we move towards the air show. And again, issues like not maybe to the extreme that you heard tonight happen every single year. That's part of running events, it's part of running the airport, but we work through those issues. And as Don mentioned, there's other awards that the air show receives. They receive awards from the FAA for being a safe air show. It gets recognized all throughout the country as one of the better air shows. But yes, there are issues, and yes, we have to work through it. I don't think it's any different than any other volunteer organization or large community event. I think that those are my comments. Thank you.
Can I?
Okay, Commissioner Johnson.
there any way that in one of these meetings or with the big people, whoever they are, that they understand that they are visitors and that they are guests of the airfield? I mean, I think what I hear is it's a lot of ego.
The comment to that is I think my first year when I came on board, this will be my first air show, I felt that. And it was through the debrief of that air show that each year we work towards making them understand that they're visitors and guests. And for the last 2 years, at every single board meeting that I've attended, at least once, if not twice, coming from the top down, they remind all of their board members that they are guests for the weekend, that they are guests, that there's business and operations that have regular airport operations that they're here. And again, I believe wholeheartedly they're trying. It's just from my outward perspective, I'm not part of the volunteer organization. I think it's tough. I think it's tough trying to find volunteers that will commit themselves to monthly meetings leading up to the air show, and then weekly meetings, and spending 5 days in a row away from your family as you go up to the air show. And so I don't envy the position of the air show trying to find volunteers and people that will commit at the highest level. And again, I do believe that there's some issues that need to be resolved. I think it, the affected parties, it requires direct conversations between the air show, direct the affected parties, so we can move forward. But I don't think anything that's happened compromises the opportunity for this to move forward. If we don't move it forward, we wind up having to have a special meeting probably a week before to try and get this through to City Council. Timing such that this has to be approved at least 2 weeks prior to, or timing is such that I can't get this in front of City Council until 2 weeks after we've had the meeting. And then further, the permit has to be done so they can get their special event permit through the City of Salinas, so.
Could I ask a question?
You know, I think we've beat this thing around pretty good, and I think we're in a, hold on a minute. I think we're in a position where we need to make a decision on the permit. I think Mr. Chapin has heard us, and we've heard from Mr. Teeters. And I think we have to give them a chance to rectify that in their own right. And that's not something that the Airport Commission, I think, is obligated to do. Our job is to approve the permit, and I think that's what we need to get on with. We've heard that. Mr. Chapin's heard us. Mr. Teeter's heard us. So I would entertain a motion on the permit.
I'd like to move that we move the permit forward.
I'll second.
Is there a second?
Yeah, I'll second that.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded.
I have a question.
Comment. Can you make a motion to, because the permit that you have in front of you has the $10 million liability portion.
Yes, I know.
So, can you make the recommendation with $5 million air meet liability policy and $1 million commercial general liability? It was a typo on my part.
I meant to do that, actually. I've overlooked that. Yes, I'd like to move the permit forward with the change that the insurance for the air show insurance will be $10 million. The general liability insurance will be $1
million. Is that correct?
That's
correct.
Okay.
Okay. And you go with that with yours?
$5 million,
wasn't it?
Yes.
$5 million air meet liability, all occurrence, all risk. So it's a $5 million air meet policy with a $1 million commercial general liability policy.
Yeah.
Okay, so $5 million and $1 million. That's your motion?
That is my motion.
Okay, you second that, Mr. White?
Yeah, I'll, yes.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion on the permit? Not, we have the roll call, please.
Commissioner Sonio?
No.
Commissioner Fors?
No.
Commissioner Johnson?
Aye.
Commissioner Purvis?
Aye.
Commissioner Shoemaker?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Chairperson McGregor?
Aye.
Okay. Now we're down to administrative reports. Exclusive negotiating rights agreement with R.N. Baroli for property located at the Salinas Airport. Mr. Goodown.
So I'll go back a slide here in just a second. I just wanted to give everyone an idea of the parcel that is we're talking about. We're talking about the undeveloped area out in front of the airport terminal. It's surrounded by Skyway Boulevard, Mortensen Boulevard, Mercer Way, and Airport Boulevard. And this is the 13-acre parcel. And I believe we've talked about this once or twice before. So just providing the commission an update. What I want to say is this is very, very high level. We're not at a position where we're negotiating a long-term lease. We're still trying to develop what type of development would go in there, the types of property uses, all the while trying to ensure that the development would be compatible with the airport. So again, this is very high level. I don't have color schemes. The exhibit that I'm going to show you is conceptual. So any questions and comments, can they be directed from that standpoint? I don't know who tenants are. Again, we haven't even negotiated a lease. My last point here is a lease to come before commission in 2019, summer, spring, summer. So that's how far out we are. We're going to have many more updates and discussion about this potential development as we move through. So one of the primary things that we're working through is the exclusive negotiating period. And I know I've chatted about this before with the commission, but for anyone that is new to this, an exclusive negotiating period is that we've advertised the property available. We had a developer come in and tell us, hey, we want to start spending money on doing some conceptual ideas. So can we lock up this parcel while we're negotiating? So that way no one comes in and tries to undercut them while they're expending dollars. So the exclusive negotiating period, that's where we're at. And that's a six-month period that we're working through. And there's just a lot of conceptual ideas that we come up with during this process. And as we finalize it, again, we'll bring it back to the commission for comment, review, and recommendation. As of this last week, we started the process where we're going to reach out and try and ascertain what the fair market value for the property would be. We don't know. We have an idea. We've had some appraisals done in the past, but these are older appraisals at different times when the market was different, and the appraisals have never been centered around a potential development. So we want to kind of hone that into a potential development and determine what the fair market value for that would be. Just as a reminder, the property as the FAA concerned, is half of it is for non-aeronautical development, which would be the eastern portion, and then the western portion is still deemed aeronautical. So we have to work with the FAA and do a land use change from aeronautical to non-aeronautical, which is part of the NEPA environmental process that I have listed down there. And when you go non-aeronautical, the FAA requires that we charge a fair market value for the land. The highest, best use, fair market is what the FAA will accept. Additionally, as we begin discussing and determining what are the appropriate uses, again, something that's compatible with the airport, the project developer can begin developing a project description. Without a project description, the project cannot move forward. We cannot do any environmental analysis. We can't do any releases with the FAA. And we haven't even got to a position yet where we've determined what the official project description is for that property. All environmental will be considered, and the cost will be borne by the developer. When we first began discussing this, the land release was viewed as a standalone process. Well, actually, it's an environmental process. And so We were working through possibly bringing a consultant on to help us work through the land use change through the FAA, and we had, the Airport Enterprise Fund had budgeted money to do that. As we begin discussing with the developer, working with our planning and permitting department, I mean, it was pretty clear and concise that that's an environmental process. And so no longer is the Airport Enterprise Fund on the hook for changing the land use designation. So that is several thousand dollars that the Airport Enterprise Fund can save. Lower end was somewhere around $20,000. High end, if we had to go a full environmental impact report, could have been $200,000. So no longer are we responsible for that, doing that. In fact, as of now, pretty much any financial obligation for this development has been taken care of that the Airport Enterprise Fund was responsible for. So we had to do just an initial analysis for the property, and that cost a few thousand dollars that we took care of. Any developer that's going to come in and develop the property wants to know that there's no liens, no claims on it, and so we had to do that property. It's a property report, essentially. So we did that, and we're done. So now it's just a matter of staff participating in the process and then begin bringing these items to the commission and city council for review. As part of the what we call CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act process, all traffic impacts, all noise impacts, all air quality impacts will be analyzed. And if there's any negative impact to the area, again, we will have to do, the developer will have to do some sort of mitigated measure to bring the negative impact to a mitigated level, if you will. This is one of the many proposed site uses that are site plans that they've provided to us. As you can see, Airport Boulevard is up towards the top of the screen, a lot of commercial office space, so essentially business park. The buildings down below, again, conceptually, or this isn't, as part of our initial review, we're not considering any major hauling. I know that it shows trucks and semi-trucks in those buildings, but again, as part of zoning consideration, we're not doing anything that would allow, or we're not considering any development that would allow them to run a full-blown shipping yard out of there. So it's not a Taylor Farms distribution warehouse where we would be shipping strawberries in and out all day long. This is, it would be small scale, proposed minimal impact. And again, any traffic impacts would be evaluated during the CEQA process. Any questions, high level, on this proposal?
Questions from any of the commissioners? Seeing none, any from the public? Okay. Next item, the 240 Mortensen Avenue leasing of shop space.
Wanted to bring this in front of the commission. So this parcel here, you can see it's the building, the big building with that yellow arrow in front of it. That's what we call 240 Mortensen. That's where Sean Tucker's located, R&B, CalSTAR has offices over there. In this exhibit that I'm showing here, it's the bottom right-hand space. I can't even begin to define what color that is. It's an orangish, pinkish, flesh color or something. That's a space that currently R&B is in. R&B's lease, which is the corner of this building here where you see the white trucks, you can see this is the office space, warehouse. It's actually warehouse space. It's probably a better name, shop space. Their lease is expired. When their lease was expiring, they were expressing to airport staff that potentially they weren't interested in keeping the big space in the center, known as Space A, that they were interested in releasing that space, but they were interested in maintaining Space D, B, and C. RMB is an aerial applicator at the airport, and so they have the helicopters that you can see here on the screen, and they need a maintenance shop to be able to work on their helicopters. Much more than that, they don't need. All the while, we had some other tenants come in and express interest in some shop space. And because we had the multiple parties interested in the shop space and Wilbur Ellis had expressed some interest in relinquishing some space, we went ahead and put this out to RFP. It's whether we go out to RFP isn't for a process like this. If Wilbur Ellis was interested in maintaining the space, it's probably not typical that we would do it because we have someone that's been a long-standing tenant, a great tenant, pay their bills. It's a great use of the facility. We might not have gone out for RFP, but because they express interest in releasing space is the reason we put it out to RFP. I've written the RFP as such that proposers can propose on the entire facility, or the preferred method is that they split it up and propose on space A or D, and if they need any of the center shop area spaces. It's a total of approximately 5,300 square foot. I've provided you the RFP so you could take a look at it. Primarily, the responses are going to be graded on the amount of rent that they proposed to us. We put in a minimum request for rent. It doesn't mean that they have to come through with that. That's just what other leaseholders within the facility are paying price per square foot. I actually went through all of that. I think I have the deadlines in here. So we went ahead and advertised the RFP on July 24th. It's a quick turnaround. We want to get the space re-leased out. We don't like going into holdover, if you will, on leases. But that's the status where we are. We're in a holdover, essentially, where they maintain the same provisions that they had in their lease. Asking for the RFP to be submitted by August 17th, and then we want to make a selection that day. We can get a quick turnaround on this. Our hopes is August 23rd, commission meeting. I don't know if we're going to be able to make that. If I have the opportunity to be able to write a report and a recommendation and get it to commission within a day or two, it'll be on the commission report, but I'm not sure if we'll be able to make it. If it gets pushed, it'll get pushed to September and then with an October approval by City Council. Questions?
Commissioner Purvis?
Okay, can you show me on the map which ones we're talking about? And second, are we could we lose the helicopters?
R&B,
or Wilbur Ellis?
There's a potential, but you know, it's not something that I'm interested in. We like them as a tenant, as I expressed. We have a good relationship with them, and I'm hopeful that. The party, so the other party right now is CalSTAR, and CalSTAR is not interested in that other space. So again, I'm working closely with Wilbur Ellis through the process. Like I said, they've been a great tenant. We want to work with them. We published this on the city website as one of our requirements. We didn't do a news article publishing or a circulation publishing. It wasn't something that as per the city attorney's recommendation that we did. So I hope not. My hope is that we get both of them, or Wilbur Ellis winds up taking over the whole space again. The space, again, so what we're looking at here in the picture, it's this corner that's facing us along with that white roll-up door. The space that Wilbur Ellis said that they weren't interested anymore is where the white roll-up door is. That opens up to space A, which is in the bottom right-hand corner of this entire exhibit. That orangish, brownish, tannish color is the entire space that they lease, so.
Other questions, commissioners? From the public? Mrs. Atkinson.
Brett, I have a question. So is it R&B's lease that's expiring or Wilbur Ellis?
Did I say both of them? Sorry.
Yeah, I think it's Wilbur Ellis.
It's Wilbur Ellis. Sorry, if I said right. R&B, it's not. Okay. Disregard R&B, it's Wilbur Ellis.
Yeah, I was going to say, I spoke with both of them today.
I'm sorry.
And R&B said, no, it wasn't them.
It wasn't them. Did I write that somewhere?
No,
okay,
but
I just wanna make sure.
You flipped over the Wilbur Ellis really quick, so they didn't
okay,
see
sorry.
It.
Okay, sorry, Wilbur Ellis. Mm-hmm. Just want to make sure.
The situation is Wilbur Ellis has leased the building since the 70s.
Yeah.
And then I believe CalSTAR came in and expressed an interest as Wilbur Ellis was coming due on their lease renewal. So you have...
Well, no lease renewal. It's just...
The lease is coming up.
Yeah, it's done. Yeah.
And so you have two airport businesses involved, and you've chosen to go to an RFP to see if you can basically get the best price for the building, understandably.
We went to RFP because there's potential competition, that we consider that competition for the building. It's always best price is a consideration, best use, utilization. There's some other criteria in there in the RFP, such as what type of improvements are you interested in doing. So it's not just primarily price. We want to make sure that they're a good tenant. They're helping the aviation community. How do they help the aviation community, the existing businesses, existing anything related to the airport? So.
Well, an interesting fact is, and we had this discussion when the Corriere development came up, I asked if it would go out for an RFP, and Brett said, do you want me to send it out to an RFP? And I said, I'd like for the process to be consistent. So it did not go out for an RFP, yet we have two airport businesses interested in a building, and it's going out for RFP, which is historically typical. When an aviation business based at the airport wants to do anything, it has to go out for RFP, which is fine, it's a process, but yet the core area didn't go out for RFP. Well, that's a really good deal. You know, I can understand that, but when it comes to an airport business, there's a double standard, number one. I spoke with Mark Plaskett this morning with Wilbur Ellis, and he said he's fine with giving up a portion of the building for CalSTAR to come in. So I'm just wondering, in an effort to work with the existing airport businesses, why don't we negotiate with the two airport businesses? Because it seems like Mr. Plaskett is willing to back off some of the space. He said he doesn't need all the space if he could keep the area that's closest to the runway, and he had no issues with allowing CalSTAR access. So it's something that puts the businesses at risk every time this comes up. Every time there's a potential, it's got to go out for an RFP. It delays the process 30 days. It runs the risk of bringing in yet another person, which I don't think you'll get another aviation business that'll from off the airport that'll come in, because aviation business isn't in real demand right now. But it would be nice if the local airport businesses could get the same lease policies that non-aviation businesses are getting, or, you know, being able to negotiate without having that RFP hanging over you.
One second. Just a comment. Lori's right. The core area did not go out for RFP. The reason that did not is we had the property advertised for over a year on a development website, and there was no interest expressed. And so one of the reasons you don't go out for RFP is if you have a parcel or a piece of property, a facility that is available and you've advertised it available and no one's expressed interest in it, there's no need to go out for an RFP. You've advertised it, and there's no competition necessarily that you're looking. That would delay a process, exactly what it is that you've expressed to prevent. The reason that I felt that it was best suited to go out to an RFP in conversation with the city attorney, we're always looking to try and expedite a process, and that's why we have the reduced, it's not a 30-day RFP, it's a quick turnaround, because we want to work with the tenants. So when you have competition, if you have multiple parties expressing interest in the same facility and you don't put it out for RFP, that's the type of scrutiny that can get you in big trouble. So. We tried, it's a one page, just turn it back in, you know, something very minimal is what we have to do to just meet the test that we're not favoring one business necessarily over the other, but that's right, it's competition is what the issue is. No competition, and there was no interest in the core area, double interest in one facility, and we're trying to work with both parties to make it worked for both of them, so.
Mr. Teeter.
RFP process has not been consistent, and it's because I think there's never been a real policy set over what the RFP process is supposed to be for the city. I don't think there's anything in writing that gives Brett direction of what he has to do. So it kind of has to be interpolated. I think Brett's, for the most part, done a good job. I wouldn't want to be in his situation trying to interpret what he's supposed to do on that issue, because he's supposed to do the best for the city. But yet he's got to keep all of us happy too. So I admire him for most part for what he's doing. The only thing I would caution with this RFP is you have a lot of businesses at that airport that are coming at the end of their leases. And when we're spending, there's currently buildings, the city's currently negotiating to build buildings with Taylor Farms and a group of people. And I understand now that's been put on hold because they want to work on non-airport related property, which is the core area, which I understand other people aren't happy about that. But when you have two airport businesses that want the same piece of property or whatever, I can understand saying, hey, you guys go make your best proposal for us and come back. And if you look at those, if Brett and you two, or all you people look at the proposal and you feel that it's of a better value than what was proposed, then I can understand going out and putting in newspapers. But when you've got two airport-orientated businesses that are here showing that they pay their rent, that they're good tenants, to go put stuff in a newspaper and try to find somebody else to compete against these guys is going to bring a lot of... it's going to chase a lot of aviation stuff off, and it opens the door for people to promise that they're going to do things in order to get the property that once you get them in there, they're not, and then you've lost your good aviation-orientated businesses. So I just ask you to caution on the RFP. Thank you.
Commissioner Sonio.
So, Brett, point of clarification. So you say there's competition for this space. Is it the two people that are right now in the building, one wants a little more, one wants a little less, or is there some outside third or fourth party that is interested in this?
So Wilbur Ellis, go back to, Wilbur Ellis currently leases the entire tan looking space in the bottom right-hand corner, Wilbur Ellis. Wilbur Ellis has expressed potential interest in not leasing the entire space. They don't need it anymore.
Okay.
CalSTAR has come in and said, hey, we need space, but we're interested in only the space that Wilbur Ellis is interested in giving up. And so this is a quick, easy RFP, and just so you understand, it was not published, wasn't published. And then, We weren't required to do it. So we're looking to try and expedite the process, be friendly to business. What I didn't want to get into was a position of we had two businesses that are interested in the same general area, the same property that was leased by one entity, and just working it out between them. I didn't want there to be collusion, nothing. So it's a quick process and communicated with each one of them along the way. So.
Then you don't need an RFP for this process. You find out exactly what Wilbur Ellis is willing to give up that they no longer want, and you tell CalSTAR either you take it all in its entirety, or then we send out the RFP to say, or I don't know if it can be divided up into get another third tenant in that space, because that picture's not very good up there, and I can't read this with or without my glasses. You know, but I think you're making this more complicated than it has to be. Wilbur Ellis wants to give up 2,000 square feet. CalSTAR will take 2,000 square feet. Everybody sign on the dotted line.
Okay.
I don't think it's quite that simple, but anyway, are there any other questions or comments from commissioners?
One quick one.
Commissioner Purvis.
Where does R&B helicopters fit into this?
Where's our? They're the top right, the yellow area.
Okay, so they're not moving. They're staying where they are.
No, they're staying. They're good.
Okay, good.
So you said they're the yellow, but are they the yellow on the
top
left-hand side on either side of the blue too?
Yes. So that's R&B. We don't want to focus on R&B.
No, I understand, but they've got split property.
This is just an administrative report to let you know where we are, where we're at. The RFP's due. I'm very hopeful that it'll work out for both parties.
There's no action required on this, so if you're unhappy, I'm sure Mr. Goodown's office door is open.
Okay, let's move on to the Airport Improvement Project 27 update.
Okay, so here's some good news, hopefully. Some of you may have heard, may not have heard, the FAA is offering the city of Salinas a $1,160,916 grant to do reconstruction at the airport. If the commissioners recall, I'm just going to flip over to another slide real quick. This went through commission back in, I believe, February for approval. The grant application process so City Council could approve a grant when offered. The FAA is finally ready to offer us a grant. The base bid was reconstructing runway 1331, and we had four additive alternates that we threw in there with hopes that the FAA would have additional money and fund additional projects. So the FAA is funding additive alternate one, which is the repair of a depression that is manifesting itself in runway 826. To do taxiway delta reconstruction is additive alternative two, additive alternative four is taxiway Juliet, Delta Gulf, and Papa, portions of Papa reconstruction. These are small areas. In most of those areas, as you can see in this exhibit, are what we call throats or the what gets you from the runway to a taxiway. So I don't expect you to be able to read all this, but this is breaking down into our phasing plan for the project. What I'd like to kind of highlight, and this is due to everyone's work involved, is I don't think I have the number written down. The FAA was only committed to fund the base bid, and the base bid came in just under $400,000. That's all the FAA committed. So anything that we get above and beyond that is through the work of staff and elected officials. So, and when I say staff, it's a relationship that we build with the FAA. It's our past performance on grants and ensuring that we're following the metrics that the FAA needs so they can be successful. And when they work with airport sponsors that help them meet their goals, they're more willing to entertain offers to fund additional projects as they're shovel ready. So the FAA is funding over $750,000 in addition to just its pure greatness for us. That's good stuff. So the total grant comes out to $1.1 million, just around there. And then this year is the first year that Caltrans will have grant matches available. And so the maximum that they will provide is up to $50,000. And we're going to be entertaining getting all of that. So our total contribution is just under $80,000 to do an entire runway and all of those throats, if you will, to do some reconstruction and fix the depression that's manifesting itself on runway 826. So very happy to announce that. The recommendation award is to Maxwell Asphalt. They were the apparent low bidder. And then so the only project that is left is the additive alternative number three, and that's the reconstruction of runway 826. Timing of this is we hope to have a grant offer by next week, and then that takes a week for us to get signatures, and then we send that off to the FAA. And then after that, we have to begin working with Maxwell Asphalt to get them into some pre-construction meetings. So I don't suppose that we're going to be doing anything until September or after air show. So questions?
Questions from the commission?
So,
Commissioner Sonio?
Is alternate number three paid for or not paid for?
So the design work has already been paid for, and alternate three will be our project for next year that we request.
Oh, so we're not getting the funding right now?
We're not getting funding for it right now. So.
Any other questions from commissioners? From the public? Let's move on to the local runway safety action team annual meeting and inspection.
For those that aren't familiar with the local runway safety action team, once a year we have an inspection of the airport by a group of individuals. FAA is part of it, our air traffic control tower, airport staff, and any tenants that are willing to show up. So we bring local stakeholders together to mitigate risk on the airfield, and we're talking specific aeronautical risk. And so part of this, we're reviewing any incident history that we might have. Incident history has to do with runway incursions by pilots or vehicle pedestrian deviations by vehicles. And our incident history is very minimal. We had one incident last year, and it was pilot error. They were using the old tower frequency, calling in, and they never got permission to land. So from a vehicle and operations standpoint, we're doing very good. The things that we're working on with staff and tenants and businesses are working. We discussed any concerns. There was nothing to report of really any concern. And from that, we develop an action plan. And the action plan is minimal because there's no concerns. And so operationally, we're moving in the right direction.
Questions, comments from the commissioners? From the public? Okay, does anybody have any announcements? Any general public comments from items not on the...
Bob, I think you forgot this one. The RFQ for engineering services.
I don't have that on my agenda.
It's not on the agenda yet.
Oh.
Is there an agenda item I'm missing, Brett?
No.
No.
Oh, there's just an extra slide here regarding Kimberly Horn and CNS companies.
Oh, sorry, I forgot that wasn't on the agenda. It's okay. just wanted to make I forgot because I didn't put it on there. Just a quick announcement. At our last commission meeting, we discussed RFQ for engineering services. The scorings came in. We had three companies submit, and we're going to actually retain the services of the top two companies. They were in a dead heat. And as part of these agreements, our retaining agreements for engineering services, we do a 3-year initial term and then 2 1-year options for them to work on our grant projects and other engineering projects in and around the airport. The caveat is when we enter these agreements, there's no minimum work that we have to provide them. It's just a retaining agreement that if we need your services, you are available. So I just wanted to announce that we'll be bringing on CNS companies and Kimley Horton Associates. Those items will come, the retaining agreements will come before the commission at the next meeting.
Okay. Questions, comments on that item? No, are there any announcements? Seeing none, any comments from the public that do not relate to any of the agenda items? Lori?
I just wanted to address the commission on an issue that came up in June, and I spoke with the airport manager about it, and Brett handled the situation, but I had a concern, and it's the airport assessment district. The airport assessment district is the area down Moffett Street, both sides of Moffett Street. The airport historically does pay into that assessment district, but it had come to my attention that probably around 2014, the airport started paying a larger portion because the businesses in the district voted down an increase to the assessment. In my understanding, that's not proper use of airport funds because it's not proper, it's not for the benefit of the airport. It is subsidizing business owners' assessments. This has been an issue since Jorge Rifo was the assistant city manager. Members of the Business Association met with Public Works and the deputy city manager at the time to discuss the fact that the district looks bad, it's underfunded, they can't provide the maintenance with the fees that are given to them. I spoke with city council at the time because a large problem at the time was that there were so many exempt county buildings in the district that weren't paying into it. They had a lot of county offices, the post office was over there, and they were all exempt. So at that time, they turned off the water and things started dying. And I am disappointed to say that it was our own airport manager that moved to Public Works that brought up the suggestion that the airport has a lot of money in it, maybe they could subsidize that fund. In doing a little research, I came to the conclusion that it was probably just under $20,000 that was contributed to the fund. The public works director has advised me it's over $30,000 that was contributed to the fund. The concern is this allocation was made without public knowledge at the airport commission. Yes, there's an assessment district public hearing, but funds were taken out of the airport fund and transferred without the airport commission knowing it, being advised of it, or it clearly being budgeted in the airport budget. Now, Brett has said they've put a stop to it. The public works director said they now have a reserve, so we won't need to do that this year. But he also noted in the email that there's big development going on at the airport that will be funding it in the future. And I still don't think that's right, because that development at the airport goes to the Airport Enterprise Fund. It shouldn't go to fund an assessment district next door. I know the city's in a really hard situation with their assessment districts. I know that the businesses on Moffett Street at one point tried to make it an association so that they could have the maintenance done at less than prevailing wage. I think that's something that they need to look at, because I know the tenants on Moffett Street are not happy with how it looks. And I'm a little disappointed that the airport's paid over $30,000 and we can't get the sign washed that says Salinas Airport Business Park.
Thank you, Lori. Funny you should bring that up, because I went through that same process when I was with Tandy Marinantle and was told that because of the way the original conditions were written up with the sale of that property, that there was no way that they could force them into paying that assessment if that would have been part of the conditions, and it wouldn't have been a problem. And for a while, they shut the water completely off. You remember that was brown through there for a long time, and how it got back to where it is now, I don't know. But that's been an ongoing issue. Thank you. Any other comments from the public? Future agenda items.
So what do we do about the situation that Lori just brought up?
We cannot do anything about it. It's not an agenda item. It would have to come up on the agenda. We talked about it.
Can we get it
just
on an agenda for further discussion?
There's not really any action that needs to be taken other than I will be going to the city council. I apologize. I had a family emergency and I was unable to make the public hearing, so I emailed the public works director and council member Barrera. And we had a conversation. I've been unable to actually meet with him in person, but I will be going to city council, because this should have gone through the airport commission. Yes, it's been made public, but much like the RFPs, the business owners don't know what RFPs are out there. They're not notified when an RFP comes up. The RFP goes out to the public, and there's no notification process for the airport community. And I'm a little concerned, because there was a point in time several years ago where many things airport related did not go through the airport commission. And if they're going to take money from the airport budget, it most certainly should go through the airport commission.
Exactly.
And it most certainly should be budgeted clearly on a line item that indicates where those funds are going. The funds for the air show, when they were donating for the air show, went under personnel or employment or salaries. It went under salaries. And so my concern is things are getting paid out that are not being clearly budgeted and disclosed. So moving forward, I'm making the request that anything involving the airport budget goes through the airport commission. And I will also be making that request to the city council once again. Thank you.
Okay.
You said future items.
Commissioner Purvis.
There was something that just struck a note here, is that we were going to review the airport policies, if I remember right, and that has never happened. So I was wondering if we could get that on the agenda. Or at least find out where we are with that.
Are you talking the airport rules and regulations?
Yes.
Yes, we can get it on the agenda, but there's probably a process that would be better suited before we go straight to the commission, bring it in front. There's a bunch of public workshops and whatnot that we should host with the tenants and the businesses to discuss if there's any changes that the tenants and businesses would like to see before we just bring it up to the airport commission to beat it up. So it's a matter of being able to have the time to be able to go through it and provide recommendations to the tenants. It's just, it's a time issue to be able to do it. When that went in front of the commission, the Chapter 4 ordinance update said it would bring it back when we actually go through it and review it. So it's still, I talk to staff with it pretty regularly. We haven't had the time to sit there and update it because it'll be a comprehensive update to the policy. We don't want to come in and just do one thing here and one thing there. We want to go through it comprehensively and allow plenty of time for tenants and businesses to look at it also.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other comments? Future agenda items? Next meeting date is August 23rd, and with that, we'll adjourn the meeting.